All right, so good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to lecture 29, Quantum Mechanics Part 1. So in the previous lecture, in response to your request, I decided to start a review of vector notation, especially this bracket Dirac notation. So at this stage, after having explained this multiple times to you in different contexts, I hope that you know you have understood what is the difference, why is this necessary, first of all, right? Why are there two different kinds of vectors? And the reason is because for real vectors, you can just take the transpose, the components will stay the same. But for complex vectors, you have to take the complex conjugate. And so the vector components themselves will change. So you get a different object, right? So this object is not the same as this object. They are related to each other, but they're not the same. And so we can define quantities such as the inner product, which gives you the length squared of a vector, right? And this is a positive definite quantity. And this is the whole reason why we take, the complex conjugate. So now, electricity has gone over here. So, okay. Now, so then the next thing is to understand the action of operators, right? So again, to work through all of these things, it's important to keep in mind that we are not using anything. We are not using anything like a dot product. Okay, what we are doing is we are saying that okay, we are multiplying matrices. Everything is a matrix multiplication. All right. So if I what you call the dot product, I call it the multiplication of two matrices. One is a row matrix and one is a column matrix. Okay. So there are no dots to put anywhere. Now, when you take the inner product of two vectors, for real vectors, it doesn't matter whether you take one vector first or the other vector first. But for complex vectors, it makes a difference because of the complex conjugation. Right? So you have two possibilities, right? Either bra u ket v or bra v ket u, right? And these two possibilities are related to each other. One is the complex conjugate of the other. So I hope that this expression is clear to all of you. If you don't understand where this expression comes from, please tell me. Okay, so how do we understand the action of matrices on our vectors, right? So we write the action just in the usual way. An operator, a matrix acting on some vector gives you another vector, right? And you can also take an inner product of this object with another vector. So we write it in this way, right? This is you sandwich, it creates a sandwich, right? You have two pieces of bread and you have something in between. Here you have two vectors and you have something in between, right? And then, for example, you can use algebra once again to show that if, let's say that A is a Hermitian operator, so what is the property of a Hermitian operator? That it is equal to its own Hermitian adjoint, which means complex conjugate transpose, right? So if that is the case, right, then if you write down this object, which is the expectation value of the operator A in the state psi, and you take the complex conjugate of this, right? using the Hermitian property, you can show that this this whole expression on the right is equal to the expression on the left, which means that this quantity is a real number, right? So Hermitian operators have real expectation values, and this is the reason that we use Hermitian operators as our observables. Okay. All right. Now, so today I'm going to talk about diagonalization basis change, etc. Okay. So remember that any vector can be written as in terms of some components, right? So, okay, I didn't right. So any vector can be written in terms of some components, right? Now, so again, let me see what notation I used to do. So I'll write it like this, psi I, and these basis vectors I will denote by E of I, ket of E of I, right? I is equal to 1 to n. So E of I, these are the basis vectors of my space, okay? And they are they should be orthogonal. They don't have to be orthogonal, but we will generally work with orthogonal sets only, just to keep things simple. So if they are orthogonal, then that means this condition is satisfied. Actually, so this means it's orthogonal and normal. And normalize, right? So what this tells you is that if you take the norms of any of these basis vectors, what is that going to be? That's going to be one. So these basis vectors are orthogonal to each other and they are normalized, right? Now, one can always change, perform a change of basis, right? So how do you perform a change of basis? So let's look at an example. Example, we'll work with a spin 1/2 system. So a spin 1/2 system is a two-dimensional system. There are two basis vectors, right? So we can write any vector as a sum of two of these two basis vectors, right? Up and down. I can call them 0 and 1, or I can write it like this. Okay. So this is my up vector and this is my down vector, right? I can also call this the 0 vector, I can call this the 1 vector, I can call them anything I like, right? It doesn't matter. Now, if you perform a basis change, right? How do you go about if you consider a vector space, right? Any vector space. There are two ways to perform a change of basis, right? One is an active transformation, one is a passive transformation. So in an active transformation, you change the vector, right? This is active. And in a passive transformation, the vector remains unchanged, but instead it is the basis vectors which are modified, right? So how would you represent this? You would write this vector v prime is equal to some operator, right? It would be some operator, let me call it R, acting on V. And in this case, what we are doing is we are changing the basis vector. So I would write EI prime, right, is equal to Rij Ej. Okay. Now, so this R and this R are different. So let me just call it Si. Now, in terms of components, right? Let's say that you want to express this in terms of components. How would you do that? You would say V prime I, and I'll just put everything in the subscript. Okay. Is equal to Rij summation Rij Vj, right? And summation of j from 1 to n. And then in this case, I have this Sij, right? Now, what are the properties of this of these matrices Rij and Sij? So Rij is also an n by n matrix. Sij is also an n by n matrix, right? So they should have some restrictions on them. What should be those restrictions, right? I mean, in general, I can take any vector, any matrix, okay? So if I take any matrix, any n by n complex matrix, and I don't put any restrictions on these matrices, right? Then I say that I am working with these, each matrix is an element of this group. So all of these matrices form a group. That group is called GLNC. N denotes the dimension of the matrices. C denotes that we are working with complex matrices. GL means general and linear. But we will in general have some restrictions, right? What should be those restrictions? So as an example, if you look at this vector psi, right? So this is the vector psi, right? Now, if I perform a measurement, and in order to perform a measurement, I need a Hermitian operator. Let me pick sigma z. Okay, this is my Hermitian operator. You can see that it's Hermitian. You can take the complex conjugate transpose, you get sigma z again, right? And then what happens after measurement? After measurement, the state will collapse into either the up or the down, right? And it will collapse into this with probability alpha squared and into this with probability beta squared, right? So how can we write alpha? So if I have this, how do I write alpha? Can anybody tell me? How do I extract alpha from this expression?
So in a product of psi with the up state.
Right, this will give you alpha, right? Because in a product with the up state, here I'll get 1, here I'll get 0. Similarly, beta is in a product with the down state. Right? So these probabilities can be written as half psi and down psi, right? Like this. So now if you perform basis change, should not affect the physical outcome, right? So the physical outcome should not be altered, because the basis change is like a change of coordinate. So if you change your coordinates, your system should not change, right? So let's say that I perform a transformation to a new basis. Okay, and the new basis is going to be related to the old basis by some linear transformation. So let me write it like this: A11, A12, A21 plus A22, right? Now these are my new basis vectors, right? In terms of these new basis vectors, I can write my state psi, right? So when I write my state psi in terms of these basis vectors, my coefficients alpha prime and beta prime will change, right? But what should not change? This quantity should not change. Right, this quantity should not change, this quantity should not change. And both of those conditions I can express. So now I'm going to like use a general notation, okay? So I'm going to work with n dimensional vectors instead of just two dimensional vectors. So once again, I'll write this as psi I, ei, all right? I'll perform a basis change. To some set of vectors ei prime, where ei prime is equal to Sij Ej. If I forget the summation, I hope that you can tell from the context that there is a summation, right? Because there are two repeating indices here, so there should be a summation. So I can write this expression as psi I prime Sij Ej, right? Now, first of all, if I compare these two expressions, what this tells me is that psi j is equal to psi prime Sij, right? If you look at this expression, it has to be the same as this expression, right? The vectors have not changed, right? So this is just psi. So that means this quantity, this coefficient here, should be equal to this coefficient, right? Now I can write this as summation of I S transpose ij S transpose ji psi I, right? Okay. Now, what about psi I prime? If I want to get psi I prime from psi j, what do I do? I just multiply. So now I'll just forget the indices, okay? Or maybe I'll I'll forget the summation sign. I hope you can understand from the context what's going on. So I'll just write it like this, psi f prime. Now, if you want to, you can invert this expression. How do you invert it? You multiply it by S transpose inverse, right? And let's say I multiply it by S transpose inverse Kj. So I will get S transpose inverse Kj times psi j, S transpose inverse Kj, S transpose ji, psi I prime. What is this going to be? This is just going to be equal to delta ki, and then delta ki times psi I prime is going to be psi k prime. Okay, so the relationship between the basis vectors, the old and the new basis vectors, is given by this matrix S, and the relationship between the old and the new coefficient is given by the matrix, which is given by S T inverse. Okay. Now, what do we want? Oops, I don't know what just happened. Things go crazy. What we want is we want the norm of the state to stay the same in both the bases, right? So here it would be alpha squared plus beta squared, and or it would be alpha prime squared plus beta prime squared. Okay, so let me look at this expression again. Psi in terms of this expression. Psi is equal to summation of psi I prime e I prime. So, oh, and one more thing. Before that, I want to make sure that my new basis vectors are orthogonal or orthonormal, right? So we want that these new basis vectors should also satisfy the orthonormality condition, right? So how can I ensure that that is the case? Well, let me look at this expression, right? So this is the expression for the ket vector. And now if I want to, I can ask, well, what is the expression for the corresponding Hermitian adjoint, right? Which is this vector. So what I have to do is I just have to take the Hermitian adjoint of both of these. If I take the Hermitian adjoint, what do I get? Summation of j is equal to 1 to n e j, right? And then here I will get s I j complex conjugate. Okay. Now, this expression can also be written in the following way. E I prime is equal to summation j is equal to 1 to n e j. I can write it as S transpose conjugate j I. Okay? Right? And so this is e j S Hermitian adjoint j I. Okay, so this is my bra vector, this is my ket vector. Now I take the inner product of these two. So let me take the inner product of ei prime and ej prime. And I'll have to change some of these indices because I can't repeat these, repeat the same index. So what is, or to make your lives just a little bit easier, I'll take Ej prime and Ei prime, okay? So Ej prime is summation k is equal to 1 to n, Ek, F Hermitian adjoint, Kj. Okay. And Ei prime is summation of, let's say, L is equal to 1 to N, S IL EL. All right. So now, what do I get? I get summation of k, comma l, skj adjoint sil, ek, el. What is this object? Delta kl, right? And so when I sum over either k or l, what will I get? I will get the following expression. Let me sum over k, so then I'll be left with sum over l, and I'll write it like this: sum I l as adjoint l, right? And what is this? This has to be equal to delta ij. This is the requirement. So if this is delta ij, then what does that tell me? That tells me that S Hermitian adjoint Lj has to be equal to S inverse Lj, right? Which means that S Hermitian adjoint is equal to S inverse. Right, and such an object is called a unitary matrix if it satisfies this condition. Okay, so if you have a unitary transformation, then your new basis vectors are also going to be orthonormal. But there's also another nice result that you can show. Prove that if S adjoint is equal to S inverse, then norm of psi square is unchanged. Okay. So this is a consequence of this requirement. So if I have this unitary transformation, then my norm of my vector will be a constant. Okay, so I have left that for you as an example. All right, now, so all of this, the question is, right, I've been talking about finite dimensional spaces, right? For example, spin 1/2 or for some spin j, right? But what about something like one dimensional particle on a one dimensional line? In a 1D line, right? Now here, every position is a distinct eigenstate. Right? That means I can have x and x prime. These are distinct eigenstates. So how do I express this condition? I say that the inner product of these two is this, which is the Dirac delta function. Right? And why do I need the Dirac delta function? Because this x is a continuous variable. And since x is a continuous variable, there are an infinite number of possible eigenstates, right? So my Hilbert space is infinite dimensional. Okay. Now this, there's no reason to be scared of this infinite dimension. Okay. There are some changes, such as, for instance, in a finite dimensional Hilbert space, you would write something like this. You would have a sum over sum n. In an infinite dimensional case, you would write an integral like this. Both of these expressions say the same thing. Okay. This one is saying that my state is a sum of my basis vectors. Here, what are my basis vectors? They are xi. So xi, for example, can represent points on a one-dimensional lattice. Right? So this can be x1, this can be x2. But there are a finite number of them. And they're separate from each other. But in this case, I have a continuous line and points can be very close to each other or very far from each other. So in that case, what I have to do is this sum becomes an integral. Okay. Now, as an example, again, we'll look at a particle in a 1D infinite potential. Okay. What are the eigenstates of the particle? Right? These are the eigenstates, right? So I've written these eigenstates as ket n. And how many are there? There's an infinite number, right? Because n can take values from 1 to infinity, right? Integer values. So if I have a state, okay? If I have a state in my one-dimensional potential well, a general state, a completely general state in my Hilbert space, how should I write it? I should write it like this. It is going to be some superposition of my first state, my second state, my third state, all of the states, right? But the same state, right, can also be written in terms of the position basis. So in terms of the position basis, what would it be? Right? So from 0 to L. So this is in the position basis. Okay? And this is in which basis? These eigenstates, they are eigenstates of which observable? These eigenstates are eigenstates of the position operator. These are eigenstates of which operator? Energy. Right? So this is the energy basis. And now the question is, how do you go from the energy basis to the position basis? Can you do that? Right? So how would you do that? Well, what I want is I want to write N, right? An energy eigenstate in the position basis. How will I do that? Well, it will have some component which I'll label with N. Right? So this is the energy eigenstate in the position basis. But the reverse should also be true, no? I should be able to take a position eigenstate, and I should be able to write it in terms of my energy eigenstates. But now my energy eigenstates, I'll put a sum over that, right? Because the energy eigenstates is a discrete number, right? So I'll write it like this. Xn, something like this. Right? Okay. Network problems. I am back. I don't know if you can hear me or not. Am I audible? I think I'll have to restart the screen sharing. Am I audible? Can somebody please tell me? Can you hear me? Okay, good. All right, so this is the energy eigenstate in the position basis. This is the position eigenstate in the energy basis. Okay, and how do you go back and forth between these two? Any suggestions? How do I extract this coefficient psi of nx from this expression? What do I have to do? Drishika, can you tell me? Or Sukman?
Yes. Yeah, so how do I extract psi of nx? I'll give you the idea for it.
Like find a relation between the energy and the position. Like.
No, that's what I'm asking you to do. No, that I give you this expression. Yeah, I want you to extract this coefficient.
Measured input by LSP, right? Basically. So that's what I have to do. And actual code is.
You multiply with bra of x.
X what? Can it cannot be this x now, because this x is already used.
Okay, x
so
prime.
I have to say something like x prime, right?
Yeah.
Or you can also use y. It doesn't matter. It's better to go with x prime. Right. So if you do this, what will you get? You will get psi of n x. And similarly here, if you want to extract this coefficient, what do? You take some eigenstate n prime, take the inner product. What will that leave you with? It will leave you x n prime. Okay. Now, if you look at what we had earlier, in terms of our transformation of basis states, right? EI prime is equal to Sij Ej, right? So what am I doing? I'm taking an inner product over here with Ek, let's say, Ei prime. What will this give me? This will give me F. So let's write the whole thing. Ek, Ej. This will give me delta Kj. And that will give me Sik. Right? Okay. So these coefficients that you have here, right? You should think of them as a matrix. It's a matrix because it depends on two numbers, n and x prime. X and n, but it's a funny kind of matrix because the rows of the matrix are labeled by X and the columns of the matrix are labeled by n, right? But all the expressions are the same. Okay, so similarly, you can write down the position basis and the momentum basis. Position basis and momentum basis. So in the position basis, your state is psi of x, ket x dx. In the momentum basis, it's the same state, okay? This is the thing that is important to understand. This psi is the same object, whether I write it in terms of my energy eigenstates or my position eigenstates. My vector psi is not changing. Okay? And in fact, this expression is not correct, right? If I want to write down this expression correctly, how should I write it? I should write, instead of n is equal to root 2 by L, is this expression correct? Right? It cannot be correct because the left hand side is a vector and this is a number, right? So a vector cannot be equal to a number, no? So I should have vectors on both sides of the expression. So what is the right way to do it? It's as follows. Root 2 by L, sine n pi x by L, ket x, right? Now, this is a...
Excuse me, sir.
Ha, yes, Priya.
So here, the ket n you're referring to is the set of bases or is the eigenstates?
It is the eigenstate, no? It is the energy eigenstate.
But sir, in the previous page, you have you have wrote psi equals to summation psi of n into ket n.
Yes.
So, but here it's look like it is a basis vector.
Which one is a basis vector?
Ket n.
This one you're asking is a basis vector?
Actually, I'm confused that you're referring to the basis vectors or the eigenstates. Because in the previous equation you have written
so basis vectors are given by eigenstates of some operator, no? These are basis states. This is the eigenstate of the energy operator. This is the basis vector, position basis vector. It's the eigenstate of the position operator. And this notation is incorrect. Okay, this is what I'm trying to tell you. This is what I wrote down initially, but this notation is not the right expression, right? Because the left hand side is a vector and the right hand side is a number.
Okay, sir.
So you can think of this, you can think of this state, right? You can write it like this, right? Where psi m is equal to zero if m is not equal to n, and it's equal to one if m is equal to n. Does this make you feel slightly more comfortable? Priya?
Yes, sir.
Does this clarify anything?
Yeah. This equation is clear. Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. And okay, so go, and then what is the relation between position and momentum eigenstate? We have already seen that. Position eigenstates are given by this expression, and you can invert this to write minus I px by h bar. So this object here, right? This quantity. You should think of it as a matrix. It's a matrix which depends on. So a matrix has to have two indices, no? So this has two indices. One index is the momentum, one index is the position. This you can think of as the, this has to be the inverse, right? So you can write it as the Hermitian adjoint, and it has two indices, position and momentum. And when we, okay, so now one thing that I have often done is I've started with an expression like this, and I've ended up with a differential equation for psi of x, right? So how did I do that? Let me spell out the steps clearly. So this vector psi in the position basis looks like this, right? These are my coefficients. So what do? I take my x as my eigenstate. Right, and take the inner product of both sides with this eigenstate, right? What will I get here on the right hand side? Remember that E is just a number. So I'll get E x psi of x, okay? And what will this give me? This will just give me psi of x. It will just pull out this number from this expansion of psi, right? If I take the inner product of this expansion with this vector, I will just get psi of x. What about the left hand side? Now the left hand side, there are two parts. One is p square by 2m, and the other is, let's say, vx, right? So again, let me take v of x first, right? So again, if I insert this expansion, what do I get? Integral of psi x prime, okay? Now V of X prime is an operator, right? How will it act on X prime? It will just give me V of X, right? So once again, I'll be left with V of X, psi of X. Okay, then the remaining expression is this P square by 2m psi, right? So here, now what do I do? Well, I have, what is my P square operator? My P square operator is minus h bar square. So this whole expression will become minus h bar square by 2m dou by dou x square, acting on this state psi, right? So I'll write that as psi x prime at x dx prime, right? Now I have this derivative, right? This derivative will act on the on this object, right? Because it doesn't make any sense to take the derivative of this eigenstate here. So I will get, once I take the derivative and I perform the inner product, what will I get? I will get minus h bar square by 2m d square by dx square psi x. So if I combine these three things together, this and this and this, if I combine them all together, what do I get? I get a differential equation for psi of x. And if you find all of this too complicated, then don't worry about it. Just understand how to solve these differential equations, just understand boundary conditions. If this bracket notation is something that, well, you think you can't understand, it's not making any sense to you, well, you don't need this in order to do quantum mechanics. It is needed if you want to do modern quantum mechanics. But if you want to do traditional quantum mechanics, you don't need it. But modern quantum mechanics involves things like quantum computation. And so if you want a career in today's day and age, then you should understand how this notation works. Okay, so this is it. I think this is sufficient. I'm not going to go into this notation in any more detail. And starting in our next class, we resume our, we'll continue looking at this harmonic oscillator. And I have to talk about the time evolution of the harmonic oscillator position and momentum variables, and connect that to Ehrenfest theorem, right? And then we have to have a quiz also. So probably like in the first week of January, we can do that. Okay. And for homework two, I will let you know, I'll give you some more problems and then combine that with all the problems that I've given you in class, and you can submit that online at some point. Okay. All right. So I'll stop here and, questions. If you have any questions, you can ask. If you don't have, you're free to go. Okay.
Okay, thank you, sir.
All right. Bye bye. Any questions? Sukman,
Sir, I have a doubt regarding the commutation relation.
Yes, tell me.
So if we write a commutation relation of, let's say, non-commutation relation, like those XP
can
or...
Can you speak a little bit louder? Hello, one second.
Sir?
Go ahead. Tell me.
So if we take the commutation relation of that ladder operators A dagger A equal to 1. So if we take the trace of both sides, the trace is remaining not equal. That is, LHS trace is 0 and RHS trace is not equal to 0. What that actually means?
RHS trace, which one is 0 you're saying?
A dagger A. The commutation bracket of A dagger A.
Why is that trace 0? I see what you're trying to tell me.
Yes.
That if you have two matrices, right?
Yes, sir.
And you are saying, okay, that gives me some, let's say, some multiple of some third matrix.
Yes, sir, something.
Now, if you take the trace of the left-hand side, right, you have trace of AB minus trace of BA.
Yes, sir.
Right? And that's trace of AB minus trace of BA. Right? Yes, and so then you would say that, well, this is equal to 0. But trace of C is not equal to 0.
Yes, sir.
Right? Now, this is true for finite dimensional matrices. Okay.
Okay.
For infinite dimensional matrices, this condition is no longer necessarily true.
Okay.
And A and A dagger are infinite dimensional matrices.
Okay, sir.
Right?
So in this way, we can check the dimensionality of our problem, right?
You could, yeah, possibly.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
This is related to another question that comes up, which is that if I say that I have two operators, position and momentum, and then once again, the same line of reasoning requires that position and momentum should be infinite dimensional operators, right?
Yes, sir.
But then you have all these finite, you have lattice systems, no?
You have electrons
in a lattice.
Ah, okay.
Right? Electrons which are hopping from atom to atom or from side to side in a lattice.
Huh.
Right? So you can consider a lattice with n sides.
Okay.
Right? And there, that is a finite dimensional Hilbert space. Right? This is a finite dimensional Hilbert space.
Okay.
The electron can be in either one of these n positions. So the basis vectors are these eigenstates. Xi means you are in the first site. Xi means you are in the ith site. Okay.
Okay, sir.
So now one can ask, well, how can I define momentum? Is there a definition of a momentum operator, right, which would satisfy this kind of a constraint? So what you have to keep in mind is that what does momentum do if you act on some wave function, on some function. If you take exponent of minus I h bar delta x p hat f of x, what do you get?
Is that the same state with some coefficient?
I've worked this all out, right? Haven't I worked this all out in previous lectures?
Yes, sir.
No, I mean, if I'm not, you please tell me. Because I teach so many classes, I might get confused.
And no, you know, f of x plus delta x, what you mean by that?
No. So what does the momentum operator do? It generates translation. Right? That momentum is it?
It's pull out the momentum eigenvalue.
Right, but the net effect is that it will generate a translation.
Okay.
You don't remember any of this? If you write the momentum operator as minus ih bar d by dx, substitute that in here, do a Taylor series expansion.
Yes.
So we say that momentum is the generator of translation, right?
Yes, sir.
So that means the action of the momentum operator should shift your state. It should change your state, right? So if I have my particle at site 2, I should be able to act on this with some operator, right? Like this, minus ih bar delta x p hat, and get another state which corresponds to the particle being at site 2, right?
Okay.
So now the thing is that, so in such a system, we cannot define p hat, okay, such that this commutation relation is valid, okay. But we can define something else. We can define a unitary operator u delta x, which is equivalent to taking an exponential. I think this h bar should be probably be, yeah, down here. Okay. So you don't need to be able to define these operators, because what you actually work with are these unitaries.
Okay.
Right? And you should be able to define these unitaries. Now one can ask, what is the commutation relation of these unitary operators? Right, so one can define two unitary operators. U delta x is equal to minus I delta x p by h bar, and then v delta p would be exponent I delta p x hat by h bar. And then one can ask, what is the commutation relation of these operators, right? And the commutation relation of these operators is the same regardless of whether you are in the infinite dimensional or the finite dimensional region. Okay. Okay, well, I don't know if this makes any sense, but you can think about it. This is known as this is called the Weyl-Heisenberg algebra, for anybody who might be interested in looking it up online. Okay. All right.
Okay, thanks.
Any other questions? Yes.
I understood the significance of passive transformation, but I couldn't get the importance of this active transformation.
Well, active transformation.
Why do we need to change the vector?
So, So you remember the Schrodinger picture and the Heisenberg picture, remember that?
Yes, sir.
So that's exactly what is going on there, no? Right? Vikash, if you have a question, please ask. Otherwise, there was some audio disturbance from your side. But if you have a question, please ask, okay? So Sukman, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Right, so if you have the Schrodinger description, what does Schrodinger description tell you? It tells you that H psi, right, is equal to E psi. And you can write this as, H psi is equal to I H bar d by dt psi, right? And then you can solve this equation, right? You can write it like this, right? Exponent minus I, minus I H bar by H bar, integral from T prime to T of H, T double prime, dt double prime. Do you remember this expression, Sukman?
Yes, sir.
So this I'm writing down for the general time dependent Hamiltonian. To make life simple, you can consider a time independent Hamiltonian. Right? For a time independent Hamiltonian, this would just be H delta T, right? T minus T prime. This is for the time independent Hamiltonian. And this is a unitary operator, right?
Yes, sir.
Right? It's a unitary operator because H is Hermitian. And so if you take the adjoint of this expression, if you have exponent of IA and you take the Hermitian adjoint, what do you get? You get exponent minus I A adjoint. And if A is Hermitian, you get minus IA, right?
Yes, sir.
So if you multiply this with e to the IA, you get the identity.
Yes.
So this operator is a unitary operator, right? Because its adjoint is equal to its inverse.
Yeah.
Okay. So what is this? This is an example of an active transformation. Okay.
Yeah.
And in the Heisenberg picture, what do we have? We have that operators, the time evolution of an operator is given by this expression. Right?
Yes, sir.
And we say that states don't change. We say that the state does not change, but the operator changes. So this is like a passive transformation. Because what you are doing is you are changing the operators, right? Sukman, you're there?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
So how do I define an operator? Remember that an operator is defined in terms of some matrix elements, no?
Yes.
So what are the matrix elements? I take my basis vector, right? This is my matrix element of my operator, right? Now I'm saying that my operator becomes time dependent, right?
Okay.
So that time dependence can be understood as being due to the time dependence of my basis vector.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
So, So one way to look at this is that if I perform a unitary transformation on this EJ, that gives me EJ prime, then what will happen to this expression? This expression will become, okay, never mind. I think I'll just stop. I think you all have a class, no? You should go to that class. No? But if you have, you can ask me these, continue asking me these questions on Telegram or on Moodle, okay?
Okay, sir.
If you are not going to that class, then you can ask me the question here only and I can continue.
Sir, the class is at 3:30.
3:30? Ah, I suspected something like that only.
Sir, just message right now. He messaged now that the class is at 3:30.
Okay. That's fine, Priya. It's okay. I don't doubt you.
Thank you.
So this is like a passive transformation. At least that's how I would think of it. I might be wrong.
Yeah, sir, I got it.
Right. If you really want to like drill into the details, you can do that. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And going to back to this Schrodinger picture, this psi is equal to some alpha 0 plus beta 1, right? Let's say we write something like that. Or we write it like this. We write it as psi of n times n, right? So this is, let's say, the energy basis. And these are the energy eigenstates. Okay? So these are the eigenstates of my Hamiltonian. Okay? Then what will happen when I act on psi with this time evolution operator, right? If I act on psi with this time evolution operator, what will I get? These psi of n, these are just numbers, right? So this time evolution operator will act on these states n. Yes?
Yes, sir.
And what will be the result of this operation? What will this give me? This will give me e to the minus e n t by h bar n.
Yeah.
Right? And now this expression can be written as psi of n t. Right?
Yes, sir.
So my coefficients have become time dependent. They have picked up these phases. So my state, my state psi t is written as in terms of the same basis vectors, but with time dependent coefficients. Right? So you can see clearly that this is what we mean by an active transformation, right?
Yeah.
Now I'll let you work it out for the case of the Heisenberg picture. And you can let me know, if you do that, you can let me know whether or not a Heisenberg picture does correspond to a passive transformation, okay?
Okay, sir.
All right. So I will stop here now.